everyone. Today we have with us Samatha Mathew. She is a BTech in Biotechnology and Biochemical Engineering from Mohandas College of Engineering and Technology, Trivandrum, Kerala. She did her MTech in Biotechnology and Biochemical Engineering from IIT Kharagpur. She was also an exchange student at TU Aachen, Germany through the DAAD exchange program. She did her master's dissertation there. She worked as a project fellow at CSIR IGIP for 2 years before enrolling into the PhD program. Her PhD is about studying the role of long non-coding RNAs in blood vessel development in the model organism zebrafish. She works with Dr. Sridhar Shivasubbu, and their lab is a functional genomics lab. She has always been involved in SciComm activities other than doing her science itself. We welcome you, Samatha ma'am.
Thanks a lot, Dali and Mansi. I'm really excited and very humbled to be part of unraveling the sheroes of STEM. I've always been on the other side, but I really want to commend both of you for this venture.
Thank you, ma'am. It's a pleasure to have you here.
Likewise.
So, ma'am, we would like to start by knowing if you had any role model while you started your science journey or not.
So the frank and truthful answer is no, because my family wasn't really who talk about science. So I got to know about science and scientists much later in my life. But after my 10th, I chose to go into the science stream. It was a very independent choice. My family wasn't really sure if I should do it. And when I got a chance to do research, I really liked it. And that's why I chose to do science, not exactly because I had a role model and then I went into science.
Okay, ma'am.
So ma'am, next we would like to know more about your current work.
Yeah. So like I said, I'm part of a functional genomics lab led by Dr. Sridhar Shivasubbu. This means that it's a very diverse lab where we work from problems ranging from human genomics for addressing rare diseases to modeling cardiovascular diseases in zebrafish to mitochondrial biology to long non-coding RNA biology. So I am part of the non-coding RNA biology team. And I'll just give you the basis of what is non-coding RNA. So after the human genome project was undertaken, it was found that humans also have around 20,000 protein coding genes. And after that, there was one more project called as the ENCODE project, which showed that actually there are parts of the genome which is called as junk DNA, but these actually give rise to RNA. And these RNA flout the central dogma. So the central dogma says that DNA makes RNA, RNA makes protein, and protein makes the cell. But there are this whole classes of RNA which do not make protein, but functions just as RNA. And long non-coding RNAs actually make a huge part of these non-coding RNA, and they're abundant in all eukaryotic cell types. Now, if you take a simple example or a very well-studied example of a long non-coding RNA or an LNC RNA called as ZIST, and this is responsible for dosage compensation in female mammalian cells. So basically, female mammalian cells have 2 X chromosomes, and at a time, only one of them should be active. So this LNC RNA called ZIST, and there are many other LNC RNAs together, lead to the silencing of the second X chromosome, and this is how dosage compensation happens. Now we work with an amazing model organism, zebrafish. It's amazing because when it is an embryo, it is a transparent embryo, and you can visualize the development of a heart or a brain, just live. And this happens within few days of since the babies are born. And if you tag these cells with fluorescent markers, you can actually visualize in real time how each of the organs are formed. And when you click pictures, you get very, really beautiful images, right? So like I already said, I joined the lab in a project which is already undertaken by my senior, where the lab had identified some new LNC RNAs from endothelial cells. Endothelial cells actually line the blood vessels. And so I picked one of those new LNC RNAs, and now I'm trying to understand what is its role in the blood vessel development in zebrafish. So for this, we use reverse genetic techniques like antisense oligo-mediated knockdown or gene editing. Now, everybody knows about gene editing because of CRISPR. At that time, we were using another gene editing tool called as Talin. Now, we are also using CRISPR. So when you basically switch off this new gene using either the knockdown or gene editing, what happens is there's a hemorrhage phenotype which is formed. And this is similar to stroke. And this word is again now familiar because of the COVID situation. So in a stroke, people, the blood vessels leak and the blood cells come out and the organs around which this happens, they stop functioning, right? So, and this stroke is specifically which happens in the brain. So now an outcome of my PhD would be that if I can identify the role of a new non-coding RNA in these processes. These processes have been very well understood in the terms of protein-coding genes, but now we could bring a novel regulatory angle by RNAs into this. So that's what my PhD is about.
Yes, ma'am, it's definitely an interesting work. So ma'am, we would like to ask you that during this educational journey which we discussed earlier, did you come across people who discriminated against men, women at the workplace?
So if you ask me if there was an instance where a man calls a woman and says that I will not give you this opportunity because you're a woman, no, that did not happen, because I think I was extremely lucky to work in places where such things really don't happen. But there are some things called as microaggressions, which I think I've learned only recently how to identify them. And this is also thanks to the women scientists who speak out about these things, right? So I'll just give you a simple example. When we start bachelor's, it's a girl subject. Like most bio subjects are like girl subjects. In my bachelor's, I had like 30 plus girls and just seven guys. And that was same for all batches, right? But by the time I reached my PhD, I realized that the ratio had become almost 1:1. And then I thought one level higher at the faculty level, men are more. And IJB is a place where there is, relatively better representation of female faculty. But if I think back to my master's, the department never had even one female faculty. And the students were still majorly female. So this meant that they never had anyone to look up to. So this thing is there. I'll give you some examples of microaggressions which I've experienced or have witnessed. So for example, if there's a gathering and there's a talk, guys, after the talk, the guys will get up and ask a question. There is no emotion spared, right? The other person will just listen to the science part of it and answer it. But I've observed particularly with some sets of people, if a girl or a woman or I ask a question, they take it very offensively. They are just not used to being around women who ask questions or who have opinions. So that's what I felt. And another thing which I really feel is that guys usually are very like super confident. They will do the experiment one time. They'll just announce that, see, I did this. I'm sure that this is how it works. And everybody will take it without much criticism. But at the same time, me or a female colleague, women usually meticulously plan experiments and do them. But if we go and say, I have this data, they'll be like, are you sure? And it's also the women, right? We are not really that confident. We'll be like, I think so. And so the person opposite to you again says that, I think you should try it again. So this keeps on happening. And another thing, some comments I've heard is like, women scientists become scientists because they have reservation, which I find very offensive. And another comment I've heard someone say is that, oh, she chose to take a career break right now to make to have a baby. So there is no way she'll make it now. Her career is over. So these are really irrational, I feel. Another thing is about being labeled as too emotional. This is not really for STEM field, it is generally everywhere. I can't remember, most every single day there'll be at least one guy I'll come across shouting at somebody for something very small, really trivial, right? But then if a woman sheds even one tear, suddenly everybody will be like, you can't handle pressure. You know, you are not up for this. They are both emotions. Anger and sadness are both emotions. And sometimes women cry even when they are angry. So it's just not justified that guys can shout their heads off whole day and then only women are told that they are not fit for it because they're emotional, right? And one thing I face particularly is that you shouldn't raise your voice. This happens very often. I find that men really like to intimidate women by raising their voice. And there are women who actually get afraid when they hear loud voices. But this does not work with me. I can also raise my voice. But the problem is the moment you raise your voice, they'll be like, how dare you raise your voice? And so the whole point of my argument is lost and the focus is now completely on the volume or the decibel of my voice, which doesn't make any sense to me, right? And another thing I've heard is that women aren't good leaders. It's just a general notion, just prejudice. You hear things like, oh, she's leading that project. Probably it's not going to work out. Why? Just because she's a woman. And this leads me to the next point that there's a generalization of bad examples. For example, there's an organization where there are four women. Two of them are somehow labeled as not good. And then suddenly it's generalized as all women are bad. But there are 20 men, right? Five of them are really good. 10 of them are okay. Five are really bad. But these five really bad people are never visible because they're masked by the rest of the men. So basically the N number for women is anyways so small. And if even one of them makes a mistake, it's simply generalized across that all women scientists are incapable of doing some things. And this is not only about men, right? Especially in Indian culture, women are as much misogynistic as men, right? And I catch myself doing this. I sometimes say that for this work, I need a guy. And the solution is that probably we should say that we should collaborate with a guy when I need something, but I still need the woman member on my team, right? I'll take a specific example where once there was this argument, the guy was talking to me very, very disrespectfully, and he was going on, and I'm not the person who will listen to it. So I was giving a counter for every point he was making. And then there were women around me who were shaking their heads or they were laughing at me because they thought that I'm overreacting. And what is so unbelievable is that when that guy tells me, "Tum kya kar logi," or which means that what will you really do? It's not only about me. When he's insulting me as a woman, it means that he's indirectly insulting all the other women too. But women don't realize that because we are so conditioned to believe that we should say okay, okay to everything. We should be, you know, calm and composed all the time. We can't raise our voices. So these are some things which I've really observed. And I'm sure that if I go forward, the hurdles only are going to increase. And I've read and I've seen, like, people have shared that by the time they reach a higher up position anywhere in academia, they are labeled the historic bad bitches. Sorry for the language, but that is the truth. And just look at what we are doing right now, right? This is so much more of extra emotional work. All this talking, and this is true also for non-binary minority genders too. We spend so much of time talking about the emotional labor that we are doing, but all this time men are just focusing on their science, right?
Yes,
so that's about.
Yes, ma'am. Also, I would like to add that we believe that women should support women, so there will be a platform for each woman, each and every woman, and for participation and for recognition. So for that, support is really important.
Yes, definitely.
Okay, ma'am. So we would like to ask you about three people who have inspired you or supported you the most throughout your journey.
Is this more about people in my personal life who have supported me, or is it more like people I look up to?
As you like it, ma'am, as you like it.
I would say that my mother is the person who really supports whatever crazy ideas I come up with. She always supports me. Sometimes she disagrees with me, but still she would support me. And she's a working woman. I have seen her go through a lot of sexism at her workplace. So I get I've seen this before, and now when it happens to me, for me it's easier, in fact, to take all this, because I'm primed to this. Other people, I have friends. I'd like to mention Monica. She's doing PhD at IGIB right now. She is a person I really admire. She has her own personal problems, but she's one person who really likes to focus on on the science in spite of all that. Another person who really inspires me is Dr. Ambli Shivadas. She's right now at St. John's Research Institute, but she did her PhD from IGIB. She's a multi-talented person. She has so much, she keeps on giving and is so, so inspirational. And in spite of all that, she's really, really down to earth. So these are the three people I'd like to mention.
Okay, ma'am. So ma'am, next we would like to know, what, according to you, are the reasons for less participation and recognition of women in STEM?
Okay. This question, however you ask with STEM or without STEM, it's same, right? It's the society which has led to this whole thing. So the thing is that now we have come so much forward that we are having these discussions. We are already educated, and now we are talking about our careers. But the problem is, even now, when women get a degree, it's like you get a degree so that you can get married, or you get a job so that you can get married. But that has to change. Like, men have career trajectories in their mind, but I don't know how many women are really encouraged to have career trajectories. And finally, if a woman gets into a relationship, the compromise is always expected from the woman, right? Why this really affects, I mean, the viewpoint which I have is that biologically, men and women are different. You cannot change that, right? So women have this extra burden of childbearing. So instead of incentivizing women so that they can be at par with men, it does the exact opposite, and that to the extreme, that don't even attempt doing manly things. Which doesn't make any sense to me. So these are general things. But for STEM, why it makes a difference is that the career path, right? People like my mother, they got into a job in early 20s, and she had a family, she had kids, but she was never afraid of losing the job, because the job already has all those provisions, and now she'll retire at 60. But in STEM, it's like running a marathon. Each of these degrees we are doing is like a lap in the marathon. So the people who have to stop in between or take a break, the women actually blame us, is that, oh, I no longer fit in, so I have to back out. So this happens. And I think the most important distinction is the work culture. This STEM field is where you cannot work from 9 to 5, right? People like my mother come back from office, and till she goes back to office, she doesn't have to worry about her work. But for us, when we come back home, we still have to worry about it. And usually it's the women who do all the household work and taking care of kids, tutoring them. And I'm not saying that all men just don't do any of this. There are men definitely who help at home. But still, if you compare, you will see that men always have more free time than women, which helps them focus more on science. So this is what happens.
Yes, ma'am. These are definitely the loopholes of our system, I guess. And ma'am, lastly, we would like to know that what message would you like to give our society in order to make them more aware about the education of girls?
Right. So I will not pretend that I've come far enough in my career to give advice. And I acknowledge that whatever I said till this point comes from a position of a lot of privilege. So, and more importantly, I have to acknowledge that I've got to know a lot of brilliant and extraordinary women scientists. And there are definitely men who are allies of these women and support them. So these people have actually made inroads for us into the STEM field, and we just need to follow them. So for society, like I said, the rule is, there's only a single simple rule. a family needs to match the expectations between boys and girls. Like if you expect your son to, you know, get a job and work throughout his life, it should be the same for the daughter as well. And another thing is that this, you know, society should let the kids, you know, have right to speak and even raise their voice when needed. Why I find it really disappointing that these things are there in STEM is we are all supposed to be the most educated people, really polished part of the society. But even here, women are not allowed to openly dissent or have a discourse. This is still very mythical. Women, when they open their mouth, there are people who have a problem even in STEM, right? And for younger women, I can say some things that we should really be ready to take more risks. And don't try to fit into the definition of what a good daughter is or a good wife or a good mother is or even a good scientist is. Because these are all definitions made by a patriarchal society which has existed for many years, right? So you don't let somebody else define what a success is for you. And you should stop limiting yourself. And from this experience, what I also learned is that you should always remember that there are younger women and girls who are watching you and who are looking up to you. You could be somebody's role model. So you shouldn't let them down. And like you said, we should always try to help each other. Help men too, but women specifically, because they're already going through a lot of discrimination other ways. So if you can help other women, that will be really great.
Yes, ma'am. Actually, young girls should have told from childhood itself that they have to build a career for themselves. They have to be independent. And then they can think about marriage as well. But the important thing is to be independent. Yes, ma'am. So we would really like to thank you for your time, ma'am.
Yeah.
There were many inspiring points which you told us. And your journey is also very inspiring. So thank you so much for your time, ma'am.
Both of you. Right, I know how much of work this is, and it's a really huge contribution you guys are making. I really look forward to see great things from both of you, and you guys really rock. I need to say that.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am. So we hope this will make some change in the society, ma'am.
Yeah, I hope so.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.